residents inside were able to make it out just in time. Firefighters arriving here and also able to contain this fire before it spread.
Brothers and sisters, welcome to another episode of Beyond the Shield. I'm your host, Paul Conway, and today we're going to do something a little different. Normally, I have guests on the show, but it was recommended to me today or the other day that somebody wanted to hear my opinion on some things. So we're going to do something a little different today, and it's just going to be me. I'm going to bring up a couple of stories, and I'd hope that in the notes and in the discussion afterwards, you can be able to give me your ideas and your thoughts on what you think on these things. So let's get rolling. So again, welcome to another episode of Beyond the Shield. I hope you enjoy it. So this happened the other day in the city of Milwaukee where not only a good friend of mine, but a fellow coworker who has since retired from the fire department. She is also married to a firefighter. Had an accident. They are retired, both of them. Had an accident out of state where they were airlifted back to the Milwaukee area to get the medical treatment that they needed. And truly had the best medical treatment around. But that's not the story. The story is what the brothers and sisters did on their behalf. And the fact is, this is an excellent example of where, when people come together, great things can happen. A combination from the fire chief to the union, to the rank and file, to even, we have an organization called the Firebell Club. Even the Firebell Club got involved with this. And basically, here's the story. So her husband, retired firefighter, they live outside of state. So they had no place to stay while she is getting this wonderful medical care. And it was a problem. You know, obviously, you can imagine your loved one's in the hospital, and you're out of town, you really have nowhere to go, nowhere to stay. And again, like I said, the fire department, the chief, the members, the union, they all come together and they go, look, they provide a place for this retired firefighter to stay. They found him a place to stay for the whole time while she was in the hospital and in rehab. They did this without any, you know, it wasn't an effort. It was just something they all got together on and said, look, this is one of our retired members. We need to take care of them. And it brought such pride to my heart to know that I belonged to an organization that did that, that took care of its one of its members, even though retired to that point. And the point of this story is not only that she is doing wonderful and is recovering fine, and not only that everybody came together to take care of one of its members, but I noticed the other day I saw a post where it said that someone mentioned that their fire chief is out getting accolades, padding his resume, and doing all these other things outside the fire department. Why Rome burns, as they say. Why their fire department is falling apart. And it made me think that what's the difference from the organization that I just mentioned that bent over backwards to take care of one of its members and the feeling from a firefighter in another fire department that their chief, quite frankly, doesn't care about their job. Their chief only cares about padding their resume and adding accolades to themselves. And I think that that's a deep question I think there's two parts to that question we need to look at. The first one is from the management side. I know for a fact, I worked with people that spent their entire career doing what was right for them. Not what was right for the mission, and not what was right for the organization, and not what was right for their members, but what was right for them. They're out there. They exist. No doubt about it. But are they a majority of our organizations, or are they a minimal part of our organizations? That is the first question to ask. I personally, in my 40 years in the fire service, I found them to be a minority in our organization. Those that looked out for themselves definitely were a minority where I worked. And it came full circle, be perfectly honest with you, because when they retired, they could have had their retirement parties in a phone booth. As opposed to those who put mission first, their personnel second, and their own well-being last, grand retirement parties. And not that it's all about a retirement party, because it's not. It's about having a career that you should be proud of. Having a career that you know you made a difference. You know, I tell people all the time, the job was here before us. The job will be here after us. We rent that uniform we're in. It's what we do at that time. It's how do we make that organization better? Do we know that we've done something to make the organization better, to make our people better, to make the community safer? So we have to ask ourselves, are we one of those that is out for themselves, or are we one of those that is out for the organization? I can tell you that as I promoted up through the ranks and I made it to the position of chief of operations, which is an 8-hour day in an administrative desk, sitting in an office, moving paper from this side of my desk to the other, as they say, there is no place I would have rather been than sitting in a firehouse having coffee with my brothers and sisters, listening to what their day was like, listening to what they need, trying to get a better idea of how I can make their job easier, how I can make their days better. And I also had to listen to their gripes and complaints. Which brings me to the second half. There are those, as we used to say, firefighters hate two things, the way they are, the way things are, and change. And I know that's really not true. But there are those that live every day getting up and looking to complain, looking to tear down and not build up. And I'll just use the examples I had in my life that I would listen to people say, oh, you know what, you guys at administration, all you care about is suspensions and silly rules and orders. And you gave a guy, you know, you jammed a guy up for this or you jammed somebody up for that. But see, what they didn't know, I mean, the union did because we had to get them involved. But what they didn't know is how many people we helped. How many people with addiction problems? How many people with personal problems? How many people that may even honestly have been involved with the law that we needed to move days around? Or because they were ill, we moved days around. We made things work for them. That never got to the street. It never got to the street because we weren't looking to get patted on the back. We were looking to take care of our members. So we're always going to have those that complain. But it's a small group. I used to let my guys complain when I was a company officer, company commander. I would let them complain. We start shift at 0800. Most of the guys were in by, 7 o'clock. So they got 15 minutes before roll call at 0800, which was normally done in our kitchen, to get out their beefs out, their gripes and complaints. And usually by about, 0800, I would come into the room, sometimes a couple minutes late, depending on what we had going on. But I would come in, and by then the senior man would basically say, pipe down. And that was over. We didn't allow that cancer to continue in our firehouse. We didn't let it happen. We made a conscious effort, not by me, not by the company officers, but by the senior man, the senior person, to say, that's enough. Now let's go on. Let's go face our day, because we still have the best job in the world. So I think that from the firefighter standpoint, from the line, 99.5% of everybody working is positive. It's that 0.5 that wants to be cancer and wants to come after the good things of the best job in the world. Now let's take it from the administrative side. For us, that's battalion chief and above. Battalion chief, deputy chief, assistant chief, and the chief. Let's remember this, that 99.5% of all of our members are in the street every day providing the best care to the citizens of Milwaukee, or the citizens that you serve, to the best of their ability. Every day. It's the 0.5%, maybe less, that we deal with, that we see over and over again for the same problems, the same issues. So we got to look at the majority on both sides and not forget them. The proud men and women of the fire service who are doing their job every single day without complaint. And I think we do this real simple. Let's look inside each other. Let's look inside ourselves, excuse me. Let's look inside and see who we are. Let's reflect on the type of person we are. Who are we? Are we that complainer? Do we look down upon the people in the line, the people in the field? If we're either one of those, we need to change. If we're in the field and all we do is complain, you're a cancer. If I'm in the administrative ranks, I'm in the command staff, and all I do is complain about the field, I'm a cancer. We need to, as a good friend of mine says, I need to fix myself. We need to look inside and see who we are. Because I can tell you this. If we follow mission first, our people second, and ourselves last, great things happen. And great things happen in every organization I've ever worked in. When we put mission first, people second, ourselves last. It works. I know it works. But we have to be bold in making sure we believe it and live it. Not just talk it. Believe it. You know, they say, who's they? People want to be exceptional. They want to be remembered as an exceptional firefighter. But in order to be exceptional, you have to be the exception, which means you have to be the one that stands out. You have to be the one at the kitchen table that puts down dissent. Real you know, if there's a problem with something, there's ways to address it. You can go through the union. There's ways to get things done. But just complaining about something doesn't fix a thing. So remember this. As I said before, great things happen when we put the mission first, when we put our people second, and we put ourselves last. So that brings me to another story. I heard from a good friend the other day who is in line to be a fire chief of an area fire department here. And directly or indirectly, I don't really know. He might have been told things like, look, you're our guy. You're the one we want. Well, truth be told, he's not going to be the fire chief. Now, we could look at that and say, well, that's organizational betrayal, all these other things. But I don't want to focus on that. What I want to focus on is like all of us, well, maybe not all, most of us who have these things happen to us are devastated, crushed. Because our passion for our job, our mission, our trade, our calling, however you want to put it, is great. And we feel that we always want to do better and do more. And sometimes we get setbacks. Sometimes the plan does not go our way. And we got to deal with that. So my career, for those of you who don't know, you're about to find out. My career I always wanted to advance in grade. To be honest with you, I wanted to become a captain, which was a company commander in our fire department. That was my goal. I really had no idea, no thought about being a battalion chief. My father was a chief. I saw what he had to deal with. Didn't excite me. But here I was this guy that, and please don't, this is not a bragging statement because I didn't believe it at the time and I humbly don't believe it now. When I was in our academy, I was told by somebody who became our chief of department that you're going to go places, kid. You're going to be successful here on this department. So I came in, became a firefighter, obviously. Became a driver on my first exam. It's a cakewalk. I'm going to take the lieutenant's test. Boom, I'm going to be a lieutenant in 7 years. Because this is the way it is. Well, guess what? Didn't happen. I didn't score high enough on that lieutenant's exam. Matter of fact, I had to take another one. So now I have 10 years in as a lieutenant, or 10 years in to finally make the grade of lieutenant. All right, cool. 2 years, I'm eligible to take the captain's exam. We're going to knock this thing out of the park. I had a little setback, just a setback. All right, well, guess what? 3 captain's exams before I got there. 3. Now, that may not seem like a lot to some of you. To me, it was tremendous. And I can tell you this. I was crushed every single time because I left that exam process and I thought to myself, man, I did everything right. I crushed it, as they say. And the list came out, and guess what? I wasn't there. I wasn't high enough. I was on the list, but I wasn't high enough to get a job. I was devastated, crushed. Well, guess what? I did make captain. And when the battalion chief opportunity to become a battalion chief came along, I took the test. And I made it. That time I made it on the first run. Awesome. Our next grade in our department is deputy chief. I decide I want to apply for a deputy chief. I ask the fire chief about it. Now, at this point in time, at these grades, it starts to get a little more political than just a straight exam. I ask the fire chief, and he looks at me, and he gives me an answer that goes somewhat like this. Don't even bother. You're dead-ended. As long as I'm the fire chief, you won't be a deputy. You've made your last career step. Well, I give him credit. He was honest. He wasn't going to fill me full of baloney. But here's the thing. I was younger than him. He retired. I still had opportunity. And as some of you know already, I retired as a chief of operations, an assistant chief, answering to the fire chief and the fire chief alone. So my career plan originally was I was going to skyrocket to the top. It didn't happen. It just didn't happen. But in the long run, I got there. And the point is this. Every single time, because we put our heart and soul in every single thing we do in the American Fire Service, when we get kicked in the teeth and knocked down, we want to stay there. Because we get this, at least I'm going to speak for myself, I get this approach of, well, what does it matter? They don't care. The heck with them. I'm better and they just don't know it. All those things that your ego tells you. The fact is, if you didn't make it, for me at least, I always said when I came to my senses, I'd say if I didn't make it, it's because I didn't work hard enough. I didn't want it bad enough. I didn't commit hard enough. Now, that's not for everybody. Don't get me wrong. I don't want anybody to leave here today and go, oh, so Conway's saying I didn't get this job because I didn't work hard enough. Well, he doesn't know me. And you're right, I don't. I don't know you. So I'm just telling you from my personal experience. If I didn't get something, I didn't work hard enough. I didn't focus hard enough. But I know that every one of you on the other side of this camera, they strive to be the best they can be. They work at it. Because if they didn't, they wouldn't be watching this show. Why would they care? But you care about your fire service. You care about the job you do. You care about how you treat people. You care about your fellow teammates. So, well, this is it. Get back up. Get back up. Go at it. Do it again. We all get knocked down. We all have failures. You know, so many times in my life, I used to hear people tell me, well, you're just the luckiest guy around because everything comes your way. That's work, folks. That's work. That's getting at it. Nothing comes to anybody. You're guaranteed nothing. We're sure not guaranteed tomorrow. But we're guaranteed nothing and we're owed nothing. We work for the greatest job in the world. Best job ever. That job owes us nothing. In my humble opinion, I owe everything to the job. Everything that job did for me, Amazing. And let's end this segment with this. Our plan. And we all have our plan. We all know our plan. Is not the plan. It's not the plan. There's a bigger plan than what our mind can ever imagine. What our mind can think. So most of the time, we have to always keep in mind that just because it's our plan, sometimes they coincide. Our plan is the plan. But just because it's our plan doesn't mean it's the plan. And I want to leave you with this. Tribulations create perseverance. Perseverance creates character. And character creates hope. And in my darkest days, in my worst times, whether it be because of bouts of depression or failures that I didn't get what I wanted or what I expected, as long as there is hope for a new day, there's hope for tomorrow, and there's hope for another opportunity. Never give up hope, but you have to have good character to stay focused on hope. All right, we got one more item for the day. I read a post the other day, and I really, honestly, let's be clear. I don't spend a lot of time on social media. My beautiful wife, who is also a retired firefighter, she finds things, and she brings them to my attention. And then I read them. And then sometimes like this, it gets under my skin. And I thought, you know what? We're going to put something out about it. The post said, aggressive firefighting is dead. There are no more aggressive firefighters. Or something to that form. And I thought to myself, man, that's a pretty bold statement. It's 1.2 million firefighters in the world. And somehow not a single one of them is aggressive. Somehow you've researched every single one of them. And you found none of them to be aggressive. Interesting. So, when I broke down that post, a couple of things came to mind. First off, one of the things that I've seen over the years is this. The people with the loudest mouths and the most bravado usually do the least. The people that act the loudest, usually I used to find them outside the fire moving tools from rig to rig. And again, I want you to understand, I'm generalizing. I don't want anybody to go, oh, well, he's no different. He's calling everybody out. I'm not. These are my experiences. This is what I've come to a conclusion over 40 plus years in the fire service. So first off, those with the most bravado are not the silent professionals, the quiet, silent ones, the ones that come to work every day and are very good at their job. Very good. Quite frankly, they may not be into the job, as is said quite often nowadays. They may not be really into it, but they consider it a craft, a trade, and they are the best at their craft. And they know their trade. But they're quiet and they're humble. I used to work with a lieutenant. That was one of the most humble people I ever met. And I can tell you this. If every single time he could have been awarded for a heroism medal, he was, he wouldn't be able to fit him on his coat. He was truly one of the bravest men I've ever seen. He would do VESs in rooms that you'd think, there's no way in heck you should be in there. And he'd come out with people. Truly an amazing man. A hero. People are walking the face of the earth because he did his job. But to him, he looked for nothing. No accolades. Nothing. So I can't believe those people aren't out there still. I just can't. Second thing I learned. It's easy, and I'm going to use a military term here. It's easy to talk the talk if you've never been there. Because once you have, your attitude changes. The military uses the term seeing the elephant. Young men and women look forward to combat because they think that in their head, much like firefighting, they have this idea they're going to be the backdraft poster, jacket open, baby in each hand, rescuing people, fire all around. They're going to be the one. That's what's in their mind. That's what they know that's what they would do if they were put, if the opportunity was put in front of them. In combat, once you see combat, they call it seeing the elephant, which means you've been shot at. Well, I can tell you this. Until you're put in that situation, not being shot at, but until you're put in a situation where you have to decide in a split second, are you going to put your own well-being at risk for the risk of others? You don't know how you're going to react. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with not knowing how you're going to react. Because you don't know. I've seen some people who I thought were hard chargers curl up in a ball and not do their job. I've seen others, those silent professionals that I would have thought, that guy, really? That old guy? Crush me. Run circles around me. I followed a guy that one time he came and detailed in for the day and I'm in a busy company and I told him, I said, hey, as a young man, full of arrogance and ego, hey, just stay out of the way and let the firemen do their job. How arrogant was I? Come on. This guy fought fires in the 60s. He was in busy companies his whole life. Just because he was at a slow company now, I took for granted he never was anywhere. Fact is, later on that day, we're pushing into an attic that fire's coming through the floorboards. And he beats me off the rig, beats me to the pipe, beats me to the rear door, and I'm pushing hose for him. We got all done with that fire. I certainly had a different opinion. And he looked at me and he said, hey, kid, next time stay out of the way and let the firemen do their job. Talk about being humbled. This guy had me by comfortably 15, 20 years in age. No, more, 25. And he smoked me. He humbled me. So it's okay to not know how you're going to react until the time comes. But I strongly recommend to not act like you know what you're going to do, because you don't. Once you've been there, yeah, it's much more comfortable. Because then you know how your body's going to react. But then the fact is you're humbled by it. You're humbled because you know that at any time in this job, it will humble you. And it can make a liar out of you if you walk around with all that bravado. And it's hard to get back. So let's think of it this way. Be humble in everything you do. Be ready for everything that comes our way. How do we be ready? We train. We train. We drill. We mentally go through fire scenarios. We get our brain ready. We think about all the things that can happen every day on our job. We come to work with a good night's rest. We come to work not hungover, but ready to go. Ready to give 110% every single day. And then we go out and give it. We go out and provide it. We're ready to serve and to live up to the term firefighter. There's a gentleman by the name of Kenny Three Arrows Cantrell, who has a quote that I am very fond of. And basically it's this: words are empty until they're filled with action. Think about that. Think about next time you want to shoot your mouth off, because trust me, as a young man, there ain't too many people that have a bigger ego than me. But I was humbled over the years. And I learned that words are cheap and words are empty until they're filled with action. Let's fill our words with action. Let's live our lives. Let's go out and live. Let's go out and serve. Let's go out and do our best every single day. Let's make it so that we don't have to wear a t-shirt to tell somebody we're firefighters. They know we're firefighters by our action, not by what we wear and not by the words we spew. So as we wrap this up, I want to thank you all for listening today. I hope that you got something out of it. Let me know in the comments section if this format works, if you like it. Let me know if there's some topics you may want me to talk about. Again, this podcast is put together to be a positive influence in our American fire service. We have the best job in the world. So if you like what you heard here today, please subscribe. Please hit the like button. And again, if you have comments on what I said today, I'd like to hear them. I want to have a discussion, an open, honest, non-emotional discussion. If I'm in the right direction, or if you think I've lost my mind. All right. With that, you all have a wonderful day. Until the next episode of Beyond the Shield, have a great day. God bless.